morning, everyone. Welcome to another one in our series of Brexit preparedness and contingency briefings. Today with Commissioner Tyson, who will give you the latest on our preparations on in the field of employment and social affairs. Commissioner.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, free movement of workers is one of the cornerstones of the European single market, as you all know. And many European and UK citizens have made the choice to exercise that right. Almost 4 million Europeans are living or working in the UK, and 1.3 million UK nationals are living or working in the European Union. It is our collective duty to make sure we respect the life choices and protect the social security rights of those mobile EU and UK citizens. For the Commission, it has been a clear guiding principle from the beginning that citizens should not pay the price, of Brexit, and we have been working hard for the best possible protection of citizens' rights. But let us be clear, this is complex. The substance matter is complex. Social security coordination consists of a very detailed set of rules built up over a long period of 60 years. Different situations of mobile workers, pensioners, and students are covered, and even an EU tourist who breaks his leg on Trafalgar Square has his healthcare rights protected by EU law. And the circumstances are also complex, as due to the uncertainty in the UK, we inevitably had to prepare for several possible scenarios. On the one hand, we remain deeply convinced that ratifying the withdrawal agreement would be the best possible protection of European and UK citizens' rights. And on the other hand, we have been preparing and we continue to prepare also for a hard Brexit. The withdrawal agreement offers clearly the best possible protection of mobile citizens' rights. It foresees that the EU social security coordination rules and mechanisms will continue to apply during the transitional phase until the end of 2020 or even 2022, until a definitive agreement on the future relation is in place. If the withdrawal agreement is ratified, citizens' rights are legally secured in the EU and in the UK. Conversely, in the absence of a ratified withdrawal agreement, this means in case of a hard Brexit, there will inevitably be a degree of legal uncertainty. And the Commission is working hard with the other EU institutions and the Member States to minimize the uncertainty. In the first place, we have put in place a contingency regulation at EU level to ensure minimum protection also in the case of hard Brexit. The contingency regulation assures that the periods you have to work as an EU citizen in the UK or as a UK citizen in the EU before Brexit will be recognized also after Brexit. And this can be relevant, for example, for your entitlement to an old age pension at the end of your career. Secondly, we are giving guidance to Member States and we are coordinating their unilateral contingency measures. Concretely, we have encouraged Member States to continue providing certain social security rights to those UK and EU citizens who have exercised their free movement rights prior to Brexit. In particular, we have discussed with Member States that they will continue to allow citizens to export their pension benefits to the UK, and that they will continue to compensate the UK for medical expenses incurred in the UK by European citizens who legally reside there. When a citizen residing in the UK is undergoing a medical treatment in the European Union, the patient will be able to continue his or her treatment. Tomorrow, the Commission will publish a package of guidance documents, including one on citizens' rights, where you will find further information on this. To be noted, however, that the contingency measures do not apply to tourists. We have been advising citizens to take out private health insurance for tourists or business trips to the UK after Brexit. And this brings me to our third type of contingency measures. We have been informing citizens about their rights. We issued detailed notices. We have a free call-in number where people's questions get answered 7 days on 7 in all the official EU languages. And the free number is 00800, and then it's very easy, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. It's important that you spread the message that people can phone because, as I said, social security coordination is a complex matter. We are also providing information via our representations in the member states and via our website. Now, what is not covered by the contingency measures, it must be underlined that contrary to the withdrawal agreement, still the best solution, contrary to the withdrawal agreement, our contingency measures are unilateral measures. They only cover rights of EU and UK citizens in the EU 27. They do not and cannot cover the rights of EU citizens in the UK. This being said, the UK government has repeatedly committed politically to equal protect citizens' rights in the UK, and our representation in London closely follows the preparation of such measures. Contrary to the withdrawal agreement also, the contingency measures do not guarantee a uniform treatment across the European Union. Notwithstanding our coordination, each one of the 27 member states has its own contingency measures in place, and some are more comprehensive than others. For concrete situations, citizens are therefore well advised to contact the relevant member states for precise information. The Commission services can help pointing citizens in the right direction. To conclude, ladies and gentlemen, despite our efforts and precautions, Brexit in a no-deal scenario will have a negative impact on mobile European Union and UK citizens. Our contingency measures cannot replace the withdrawal agreement, but let me also be clear, and that is the purpose of this briefing and other briefings these days on contingency, we are prepared also for a hard Brexit, and we do that as good as it is possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. Before we go into a short Q&A session, let me tell you we have also a technical briefing, as you will have seen, right after this press conference, where you can address all the more like technical questions on who is still entitled to what. But of course, the Commissioner also stands ready for a few questions before she needs to get back to a big conference on the future of work that she's hosting today together to the president, with the President. So let's start with James.
Thank you. Commissioners, James Chris from the Daily Telegraph. I'm over here. Britain doesn't want a no-deal Brexit. The EU 27 doesn't want a no-deal Brexit. The extension will be granted on Wednesday. And you've probably noticed that over the 5 days of these emergency briefings or emergency no-deal Brexit briefings, which have basically just been a restating of previously stated positions, but the number of journalists attending has steadily dropped. So I guess my question is, why are we going through this facade, this theatre, this institutional display of vanity, going over old stuff ad infinitum for days? What's the point? Thank you.
Well, thank you for this question. I wish we could avoid a hard Brexit and then we shouldn't have done all this. But as I told you in my introduction, we have to be prepared for the worst. And with all the changes and the negotiations going in all different kinds of directions in the last months, we can say, we, from the Commission side, we said we have to be prepared for the worst. So we have to tell our citizens that we are prepared, that we cannot avoid any problem, but that we try to mitigate it, and that's the reason why we prepared contingency measures. It costs a lot of energy, but we said from the start of immediately after the Brexit and from the first negotiations with the UK, we said from our side, we have to take care of the citizens and we have to make sure to ensure them that we minimize the consequences for them as much as we can do. And this is just what we are doing here. Contingency measures is contingency measures. Of course, we still hope that we don't need them because an orderly Brexit is, and that's also my personal conviction, is still the best thing that we could have. Unless, of course, no Brexit at all, because I can tell you I was never happy with this idea of a Brexit.
We have very little time, so I'll give others also a chance. I saw your hand first.
It's Georg van Herk for Channel 4 News. Firstly, on the kind of, you talked about the lack of equal treatment between member states in an event of no deal. How regrettable is that from the Commission's point of view, that the Commission isn't in charge of this, but you weren't somehow able to lay out the land where there was equal treatment for different member states? And secondly, in part for that reason, do you expect a whole load of legal action to result on citizens' rights because of the uncertainty? Thank you.
Well, as I said, we have, let me say, our contingency measures have different layers. And what we have in the regulation is about a minimum of protection in case of a hard Brexit. And a second thing we did is, next to this contingency regulation, that is unilateral, binding, and entering into force the day after a Brexit without a deal on the way that Brexit has happened, next to that, we are giving guidance to member states, and that is our coordination task. So there we have a coordinated approach, and then we ask member states, if you want to go further, you can go further, please do it if it is in the interest of the citizens. It's not about what we think about it. Our objective here is to ensure that the damage for individual citizens is the lowest possible.
Thank you. I can take one last question. Let's go for you.
Oui, David Carretta, Radio Radicale, Radio Italienne. Vous avez dit que les mesures sont unilatérales, mais est-ce qu'il y a aussi la réciprocité? C'est-à-dire, est-ce qu'il n'y a pas le risque qu'on se retrouve le jour après le Brexit, des citoyens britanniques qui peuvent bénéficier des droits, en particulier droits sociaux, pensions, etc., dans l'Union européenne, mais pas le contraire, donc des citoyens européens qui n'auront pas reconnu leurs droits au Royaume-Uni? Merci.
Well, this is indeed unilateral because this is not part of a deal. So this is not something that you can negotiate. We cannot make some mini deals for the case. A big deal is not possible. So we have to add that is the only choice if you want to protect citizens as on the best possible way. You have to act, and that is what we were doing, and this is what we were doing unilaterally. And this is in the interest of UK citizens who have rights that they are claiming for in Europe. And it's in the interest of European citizens that had things that are referring to facts and events in the UK before the withdrawal. So it's good for both citizens, both groups of citizens, but it cannot cover everything.
Okay, I'm afraid we'll have to cut it here for now. I'm sorry for this, but as the Commissioner will have to keep her commitments at the conference. But there is another chance for you if you want to join us at another press conference at 3:30 today in the Charlemagne building in the framework of the conference. That's also another option to speak to the Commissioner. And we will now take, in the technical briefing, all the further questions on the social security and employment measures. Thank you very much. Thank you.